today we are in the midst of a severe crisis. There is no experience that any of the world leaders or corporate heads can fall back on to guide them. The last year has been a learned experience for most of us. I would like to share my thoughts on how the social sector has coped with this crisis at both an organizational level as well as at a sectoral level. I would like to spend time on two concepts and the link between the two, social distance and radical collaboration. During the pandemic, social distancing has become a norm. We have all had to practice it. We have all had the pangs of staying at home. Our ways of learning, meeting peers, working has all changed. But the pandemic has also seen radical collaboration. What has emerged through this pain we saw in society that the capacity for unprecedented empathy, people at large scale wanted to help their brethren. How did people really come together at a time when staying at home and staying away was the mandate? The social sector was able to harness the power of people and demonstrate that soft power that it has nurtured over decades of working with the community is something that is important. Initially, the lockdown exposed our society's vulnerability, and large communities were deeply affected by job losses and reduced economic activity. Vani, a beautician based out of Bangalore, is also a domestic worker who cooks in several houses. Pre-March 2020, she was making about 30,000 rupees as a cook cum domestic worker in the morning in two houses, a masseur for two old couples, and ran a beauty salon in the evening. A lot of her earnings were episodic, doing bridal makeups and makeup for functions. Her husband is a fabricator and travels across Karnataka, Tamil Nadu, Andhra Pradesh, and Telangana and earns about 30,000 rupees per month. However, April 2020 saw the family plunge to poverty. Both of them didn't make a penny till September. And between October 2020 and March 2021, their combined earning is about 25,000 rupees per month. And if we look at it from that perspective, we ask ourselves, do people like Vani need immediate support? Are they identifiable as the poor today or yesterday? And this is where I think the recent debate has been. For the urban poor as well as migrants, it's thrown up several questions to us. How can the urban poor and how can the migrant workers live with dignity? Is it possible for women to retain economic independence if there is a crisis? Vani and her husband's lived experience clearly tells us that we need radical collaboration if we were to solve problems which are affecting our working populations. Migrants and the poor, however, what does it take for radical collaboration? Despite a crisis where we are all personally affected, we need to know our own strengths, our capacities, and see for ourselves that we are and believe that we are in a place of abundance. Organizations and individuals who can do this will be able to take the first step towards collaboration. We need to rise above our own boundaries and look at the problem at hand and the solution it needs. Much like what we have all read in Mahatma Gandhi's Talisman, each one of us needs to chart our own path, but together. The sector has realized that resilience of our communities and resilience for our communities will come only if we work at a systems level. And what this means in everyday life is building our network and working together even when faced with a crisis, irrespective of whether the crisis is major or minor. We all use the following phrases: make a crisis work, silver lining in a cloud, necessity is the mother of invention. Sometimes we sound cliched, and so others we think this overwhelming positivity. And how do we really, after all that we have gone through and the crisis, really cope with this? Are these cliches really, really applicable in real life? I would like to actually step back and say that we all formed a collaborative, and I'd like to tell you the story of this collaborative. This collaborative got together and realized that sanitization is an economic opportunity for daily wage workers. What I mean by this is that income earning opportunities are not devised. They land up because the time is right. There is a transformational thought An everyday observation of behavior can make policymakers, organizations like us, and if we work together, all of us can improve the lives of daily wage workers. So daily wage workers needed a job, and one of the few jobs which paid during the lockdown was disinfection services and sanitization services. So several of us organizations set up working groups to develop the job profile, prepare the communication material, organize and set up sales and operational teams, chart out the protocols and get it passed by the government, and organize funding. This feat was only possible because there was an intent for radical collaboration between state and several organizations with multiple skill sets. Today, 1 year down the line, 600 plus sanitization workers have cumulatively earned about ₹1 crore or $135,000. Philanthropists, individual donors, international not-for-profits, CSR foundations all allocated about 1 crore. Partner organizations that I referred to earlier devoted time and provided in-kind support. And today, in 7 months, a gross investment of ₹1.5 crores, 1 crore as rupees and 50 lakhs in kind in terms of time, has generated an income of about 1 crore for 600 plus sanitization workers. Several of them, about 50 in numbers, actually earn ₹800 to ₹1,000 a day. 100 more earn about ₹500 to ₹800 a day, and the remaining are earning about ₹200 a day. What is it that this tells us? It shows us that returns on investments, if one organization worked alone or government worked in silos, is considerably lower for the poor. Our experience of a radical collaboration has demonstrated that the same money can actually take you further in actually impacting the lives of an individual, and therefore the return on investment is considerably higher and can be achieved in a shorter period of time. The lesson I learned is that resilience is in acting with a sense of urgency as we spot an opportunity, commensurate to the urgency of the problem at hand. The next lesson for me was that the path to economic resilience for vulnerable populations is not straightforward. While we know that it is complex, we also know that it needs action now. It is important to understand that the worthiness of ₹100 increase in daily income is as important as building sustainable models and sustainable income for people like daily wage workers and migrant workers. As we collaborate radically and try to make the crisis work for us, we all understand that the vulnerability around us demands quick action. Now, how do we reconcile quick action while thinking long-term and solving structural problems? You see, in the social sector and in this space, the stakes are so high and the real challenges are very complex. Yet the space to fail and discuss our failures is very scarce. Where do you find the courage to act fast, fail fast, and pick up again? How do you find the space to talk about these things? In our lives, as is the case in complex problems, we have to continuously strive for improvement, with or without a crisis. Working in enabling livelihoods has been this constant motion of building inclusive business models, testing it out with markets and communities, and continuously improving access, networks, incomes, and lives for the unreached. And this means nurturing spaces for teams to reflect on what does not work and sharing this in spaces with more players in the ecosystem so we all make informed decisions. For example, the collaborative I mentioned earlier co-created the job profile of sanitization and hygiene entrepreneur, has to and continues to listen to these entrepreneurs, and the collaborative tracks and understands what is it that they earn every day. It is only this profession are they earning from, or are there other professions, which means are the poor actually de-risking every day? The collaborative needs to understand that there is a need to adapt the job profile in 2021. The problem of March 2020 is not the same as March 2021. The journey for the individual may be different, and therefore their anxieties may be different. Do I need to do something else to earn the same? I would ask myself if I was the sanitization and hygiene entrepreneur. This anxiety that the micro entrepreneur has is important to them and therefore critical that we understand the expectations as they started their journey based on our collective intentions and then decide what can be the future. It is not us devising and them implementing or being the beneficiary. It is us devising, them implementing, them devising, and us implementing and changing the job profile and therefore the program as is needed by the 600 entrepreneurs that I spoke of. There is an anxiety in the entrepreneurs on the expectation they had as they started and what can be the future. It is important for change agents and organizations to understand and work with this anxiety because we often fail short and fall short of the expectations of those who we work with. The principles of micro-entrepreneurs remain the same, but building capacities of individuals to be agile and be market-focused will ensure that these entrepreneurs continue to earn even after we stop the interventions. Coping mechanism and lifelong learning are what we are going to lead the way. The one thing that the pandemic has taught us is that the way we have organized ourselves in this world has fundamental flaws and leaves behind people in multiple ways. This could be seen as a failure of building a just society. The other thing it has also taught us is that the leaders that emerged with this acceptance, understanding these deep-seated problems that we need to solve and yet we need to find the courage to act, knowing that they will not be solved at once, is important. Education institutions play a huge role in nurturing such spaces to act, fail, reflect, and pick up again. As we take in lessons from the pandemic in radical collaboration, making crisis work needs quick action. Quick action needs to be supported by continuous and honest reflection and continuous improvement. But to act, the first question we must ask is, what can I do? Being able to contribute meaningfully, even during the crisis, personal or global, is what gives us hope to look forward. Trust me, we all have the ability to contribute, even at the face of seemingly insurmountable problems. India needs a large aspirational project. We have, as a society, understood that lack of inter-class conversation resulted in a deep crisis in March 2020. A crisis that was so stark, but in the arena of education and health care, this has been happening every day. In India needs an aspiration project to engender understanding, empathy, and this should be a place from which we devise action. I'm not undermining the pandemic, but all I'm saying is that the crisis is there and has been staring us in the face. Let me explain where there is an aspiration mismatch. The poor send their children to schools, government or low-cost private schools. Systematically, there is a problem in our education system, and in practice, there's a severe problem in quality of teaching and learning. However, for the individual, that means the child who goes to school or the parent who sends the child to school, who's a first-time learner, the desire is to get to a higher-paid white-collar job if educated and skilled. The individual wants immediate returns, while the job market does not find the individual employable or as against the productivity level that they have benchmarked, the industry or employer does not find the individual appropriate. This problem requires a slow and systematic approach and not a quick damning action. The answer is not, let's stop private low-cost schooling. The answer is not that they will never learn, they do not have analytical skills. The answer lies in us being able to talk to each other. And here I want to bring in another concept of service leadership. This could be a vehicle, simple but an organized effort of the middle class and university students talking to students from skill training centers and government schools and private low-cost private schools will cause both sides to benefit. Aspirations need to be understood and solutions structured. If the services given is sufficient or needed to be changed, we also hope to understand the aspirations from which people start. Service leadership could mean looking at local problems and asking what can be done otherwise. After all, Who can ensure that Vanis of the world embark life post school with that belief that they will have to engage in lifelong learning? With the belief that their next productive years, 40 years or so of working life, will be different from the previous? Who can ensure that a daily average worker who's likely to be a 10th grade pass student has the skill set and the mindset to continuously de-risk their income earning potentials, and the employer and sponsor and donor are also comfortable providing them with this multiple skill training and economic opportunities? Who can act to make a migrant worker feel more welcome in an alien city or make them be seen? Today, a year after the lockdown, again we are staring at a similar situation. Again, the migrant workers are trudging back. Did we learn? Did we act? And how did we learn and how did we react is the question we all have to answer. Who can work out ways and how do we empower our less privileged youth for the future of work? Summarizing, resilience to me is something which is a learned behavior. It is local patterns, everyday patterns. Resilience will be bolstered when we understand that collaboration is the only way for humans and the planet to thrive. The crisis has taught us that we can make it work for us. We can together listen to the less privileged. In material terms, this is the poor, and the understanding and the programmatic terms, it is us. What I mean is that the poor need to learn from us and we need to learn from the poor. It is us as educated policy makers and organizational heads who will have to change. It is not us versus them, but it's together that we build resilience. Thank you.